Howdy and welcome. Thanks for checking us out, and I hope when it's all said and done, you'll be able to take something from this and apply it to your own life and maybe that of some of your loved ones. My name is Mykel. I'm retired Special Forces and a media guy. Amazon Warrior Program came to me and asked me to give a talk about how I translated my time in the military to my work with the media. And I thought, okay, I can do that. It's pretty easy. Everyone knows their own story. But then I started thinking, how could I skinny that up and distill it down to one word? And when I did that soul searching, it really kind of came down to one thing: service. So that's going to be my message today, is how you can be of service to others and the great and wonderful benefits that come back to you when you sacrifice and serve others. That said, my name is Mykel Hawke. I'm retired Special Forces. I'm going to give you a little bit of background about my childhood, just because it will make sense on how I came into Special Forces and got into survival. Then I'm going to talk to you about my military stuff, just in hopes that not so much it's an I love me fest as much as it is hopefully something in there each one of you can relate to, and also to show you from my childhood the obstacles that I faced and overcame, so that hopefully you'll see no matter what challenges or hurdles are in front of you, they are surmountable. So that said, let me start by going way back to the beginning when there were two tiny amoeba. Fast forward a little bit, I'm a young whippersnapper, grown up, broken military family, did suffer some child abuse, and from that child abuse, what I learned, even though I didn't understand it then, now that I'm old and crusty, I can look back and see, I realized that that abuse was wrong, that when I grew up, I wanted to do something to help others to fight against that kind of abuse and wrongful treatment, which ended up me becoming a Green Beret. That said, moving forward just a little bit, I got into a really rough time in my teen years. My parents were split. My mom had to move away. I found myself having to survive on the streets for a winter. From that brutal winter, I realized how much I really didn't know about survival. And so that began a lifelong journey for me to learn everything I could about survival everywhere that I traveled. That ended up with me teaching survival to others, which ended up with me getting in the media and television, and that's what brought us here today. So that child abuse led me to becoming a Green Beret. That poverty and homelessness on the streets ended up making me a survival expert and then allowed me to become a media guy. So just from that, you can see you can overcome these hardships, these hurdles, these challenges, these difficulties. Just never quit and keep trying. Now, here I am. I'm a young teenager. We were poor. I fell in with the wrong crowd. I became a member of a gang. I ended up becoming a gang leader. I was also in the chess club and a straight A student. But I got shot and stabbed before I ever joined the military. And I had friends that were going to prison for killing and friends who were being killed. And I realized something's not right here. If I stay in this cycle of poverty, there's only going to be one end, and that's either death or jail. And I didn't want either. So I knew the only way to break that cycle of poverty was to get an education. No one in my family had that kind of money or background, so I heard that the military was offering college money if you joined. Well, I never went to high school. I got kicked out of junior high for fighting. But I went down anyway. When I was 16, I took the little test, scored well. They made an exception of policy, gave me a waiver, and as soon as I turned 17, I was off to basic training. So I went in and spent my first 3 years in the cavalry unit. Started in 1982, started off as a radio operator, then became a teletype operator, 31 Charlie, and then a radio mechanic, 31 Victor. And I had done my jump school and I had done my PLDC, or basic leadership course. So when I was getting ready to get out and go to school, the Special Forces recruiters came and said, "Hey, you look like you got what we're looking for." And to be point blank, I didn't really know much about Special Forces. I didn't really have a clue. So I told the recruiter, "Hey, let me do some research and then I'll come back to you." So I went and I read a couple of books. And the book that changed my life was a book by Colonel Aaron Banks, the father of Special Forces. He lived to be over 101 years old, a great person. And when I read that book, From OSS to Green Berets, I realized that's what I want to be. That's what I'm destined to do. So yes, I wanted to try out and become Special Forces. So I went off to Special Forces training in 1986. Didn't think that I would make it. A lot of guys failed in my class. We started like 360 something, and I think at the end, only three guys graduated on the first try. One was me. To my left was this perfect looking human being. I won't say his name. And to my right was this very less blessed human being. And there I was somewhere in the middle. And that taught me a very important lesson that, you know, when it comes to accomplishing things in life, it's not, you know, the smarts and the strengths and the looks and the talent. It's the heart and mind. And that's the thing inside of each person you can't see. So what I really learned from my first time going through the Special Forces training was you can't judge a book by the cover. And that's so cliche, but it was so true. And from that point, ever since, I've tried to look people in the eye and listen to their words and look at their deeds. And that's how I determine how close I let them into my inner circle. Now, moving forward, as I served in Special Forces, we needed an intel guy. And nobody really wanted to go to that school because you don't get a badge for it. Everybody was into the Halo and the Scuba and the Pathfinder and all the other dangly chewies. And you guys can appreciate that coming from a military background. You know, badges, medals, they're cool. But I wanted to serve my team and serve my teammates. So if no one wanted to go to that school, I raised my hand. I said, I'd go. So they sent me to intel school as a young NCO. I got blessed and I got to go to Advanced Non-Commissioned Officer Course, ANOC. I went on to Jump Master School. They needed linguists, so I went to DLI and learned my first language, which then began setting me on a path towards studying multiple languages over my life. And I ended up being rated in 7, paid for 3 languages, and a best-selling survival book for 20 years. So all these little things of just trying to be a better servant to my team, to my family, to my country, kept bringing blessings back to me, which all led to where I am today. Now, after the intel school and all that, Desert Storm kicked up. They really desperately needed medics. I wasn't a medic. Everything I heard said medics were really smart. I didn't think I had the smarts to do it. So I said, you know what? We need one. I'll try. So I went off to the medic course, and lo and behold, I graduated and became a Special Forces medic. So I was 18 Delta, 18 Echo, 18 Foxtrot, got promoted up to Sergeant First Class. And after Desert Storm, I still had a hunger to learn more about myself. I wanted to gather wisdom from experience. And I knew that the experience that I was after, I was only going to find chasing wars. And at that time, there weren't any declared wars to go get involved in. So I got very fortunate because my unit was close to DC and there was a job opportunity to go work in the former Soviet Union. So I took my medical training and I started a business called Global Univision, and we set about trying to bring medical care to war zones. So my first job, we set up a war clinic in Azerbaijan on the front line, and we created the first combat medic course for the Azeri Army. So it's a big blessing. Now, that was a pretty intense conflict. So again, thinking about serving my guys who were working for me and my brother, another Special Forces guy, Jay, we started another business doing tourism. The thinking was we could let guys work in a war zone for 6 to 12 months and then give them time to decompress, become more human again by going somewhere nice and lovely like Costa Rica, where we ran an outdoor kids camp. And that's where the media found us. So in this time, while we were running the kids camp and in between contracts with war zones, like working for MPRI and Bosnia and whatnot, we ended up finding that there was a high season and a low season. So in low seasons, we go off and do contract work. So during that time, I had gone off and spent like a year in the drug war in Colombia, where we're averaging like 3 firefights a week. It was pretty insane. So when I finished with the time in Colombia, I took a job working in Haiti. And I started off as just an operator. We were running helicopters for the UN after the US military left. And the bosses came down, and they found me on my hands and knees, scrubbing the floor, mopping and cleaning. And I was trying to make a nice recreation room for our air crew, who were all Russian pilots. And they were far away from home, and it was very different. They never left the base in Haiti. And I just wanted to give them something nice, a place where they can relax and have some fun. So when the bosses came down and saw me down there scrubbing the floors for the guys, they're like, you know what? We like you. We like what you're doing. Would you like to be the manager? It's like, well, who's going to turn down a promotion? So I took it. And then as I started working as the manager, I made my focus about my guys and the mission. And if you take care of your guys, if you serve your people, they will serve you and they will take care of the mission. We ended up getting the Small Contract of the Year Award 1998 from State Department for ICI, International Charters Incorporated. And that's during that time was when MTV Road Rules came to Costa Rica and they were filming a show. They asked our company for myself and my friend Jay. We were running a company called Spec Ops, and it was meant to be a company that was to serve all of our Special Ops brothers and sisters. That's why we didn't say it our names. We didn't say Special Forces or Green Berets. It was a place where all of our brothers and sisters could come find work and try to translate what they did in the military into something fun that they can believe in, that they can make a living from, and that they can pass on their knowledge and experience to others. So MTV Road Rules comes down 1998. My friend says, hey man, I got to do another contract. Can you take a break from Haiti and come do this show? I'm like, sure. So I did it. And as we were there, they asked if we could, you know, first help out, set up, and then do a reconnaissance, and then be a medic and a security for them. And then they said, hey, would you mind being on camera as sort of the good guy training up the kids, the cast? And I said, sure, I could do that. And then they said, hey, would you mind being the bad guy and, you know, helping us kind of capture the kids? I'm like, yeah, you're going to pay me to capture kids? I can do that too. So from that experience, because I was willing to serve the production crew, and in all honesty, I really liked them. They were hardworking. I found them a lot like Special Ops guys. They, like, will go somewhere wild and exotic and do crazy things and shoot people in the face, and they'll go somewhere wild and exotic and shoot people's faces. So it's like, these guys are all right. They're hard, rough and tumble hard workers. So I said, okay, I can do that stuff. So from that experience, they started asking me to come back more and more to be like security, medic, translator. And I did a couple of jobs here and there as I went on to Africa and worked in Sierra Leone. Now, my bosses in Haiti asked me to go to Sierra Leone because they knew I couldn't be bought. I didn't care about the diamonds. I wasn't in this game for money. I came in this world with nothing. I'll leave with nothing. I want experience. I want knowledge. I want to leave it a better place than when I came. Again, always about service. So they sent me over to Africa. It was the most brutal war I'd ever been in, and it was heartbreaking. And we lost. So after that war, I came home and I was ready to be with my sons again because my wife and I had gotten divorced and my sons were teenagers. And so we would take turns. It was a very friendly, amicable divorce, and we're still good friends to this day. And she's a wonderful woman. So I came back home to the States and my friends from the media business said, hey, we got this job as a segment producer for ABC. So I went to LA. I worked as a producer for ABC, had a great job, big office, great home. My sons were doing fantastic. Life was great. And then some bad people decide they want to fly a plane or two into some buildings. 9/11 happened. At that point, I was in California. My friends in New York called me when the first building went down and said, hey man, look what's going on. I watched the second building go down in horror. I looked at my sons and I said, hey, this is an act of war. They're going to call us up. I can either stay out or I can go in and serve. And both my sons looked at me and they said, Dad, you go and serve. And so that's what I did. So I went back into Special Forces after a 5-year break in service, chasing wars. Now I'm living a good life, working for ABC, and all of a sudden, war has come to our doorstep. So I go to Special Forces training, 19 December 2001. I'm mobilized, standing in old World War II barracks with a bunch of other guys that are mobilized for the war. My sons went back to my ex-wife to live with her. I sent my white wolf to go live with my friends. I went off to answer the call to duty, and now I'm a second lieutenant, National Guard, medical service branch, you know, everything that they really didn't care for. So they tried to shake me loose by sending me to every school that they could. They sent me to Civil Affairs Officer Advanced Course. They sent me to Infantry Career Captain's Course. They sent me to Combined Armed Service Staff School. So here I am, graduating all these classes with a bunch of majors and lieutenant colonels, and I'm a second lieutenant National Guard guy. Finally, they said, okay, maybe we'll let you go do the 18 Alpha Special Forces course, but first you got to do survival school in February, and it was a cold winter with 10 inches of snow in Fort Bragg. Anyone who knows North Carolina, that's a lot. I made it through all of that stuff, got through the training, and finally got to go off to war in Afghanistan, where I was the commander of 70 Mujahideen, the militia, while they were standing up the Afghan National Army, and I ended up becoming a base commander, served my time, and then when I was done, because I had already had so much combat experience before 9/11, when I was there, I wrote a lot of after-action reviews saying, guys, you need to fix things. You got to change things. This is old Vietnam doctrine. And they said, you don't know what you're talking about, son. But then when I came back, they made me the executive officer, the XO for the 18 Alpha Committee, which was a big honor for a National Guard guy. So I come back, and now I'm wrapping up my tour of duty, and I'm getting ready to go off to Iraq after 2 years of being mobilized and be country manager for a medical company in Iraq. And then my friends in the media hit me up and said, hey, man, we have this job down in Jamaica. And I was like, Jamaica, Iraq, five-star hotel, you know, gourmet meals or MREs and a GP medium. I'm like, I think I'll take the Jamaica. So I went to Jamaica, and that's where my life changed. I met my wonderful wife, Ruth England, at the time, now Ruth England Hawke, and fell in love. And we began living together. She met my family. I met her family. And so what I didn't realize at the time, again, I would love to say my segue from the military into the media was a strategic plan, genius brainchild, but no, it was completely a fluke and an accident. Basically, after 9/11 and the media had seen the Green Berets riding into Afghanistan on horseback, they started looking for Green Berets to be subject matter experts. They really didn't know any Green Berets other than me. So they asked me if I would do like History Channel's Tactical to Practical, Discovery Channel's Health Cops. One thing led to another, and they asked me to do a survival show, which I did. I think it was Science of Survival, Amazon. And from that, then they offered me and said, hey, if you could make any kind of show you want, what would you do? And I said, well, I'd like to make a survival show with my wife and maybe a special ops show with all my special ops brothers competing to find out who's the best, because everyone always asks, who's the best? And I know the answer is Green Berets. See, you can't say anything. That said, from that experience of being a subject matter expert and being invited, because I always tried to serve the production companies, they offered me things, which then led to the show. So I created shows on Discovery like Man, Woman, Wild, One Man Army, Dude, You're Screwed, Naked and Afraid. On Outdoor Channel, we did Elite Tactical Unit. On Travel Channel, we did Lost Survivors. And so it ended up, over a course of maybe 15 years, I ended up doing a film, over 50 TV shows. I got asked to write a little booklet on fire. And I said, sure, I can do that. And so I wrote the little booklet, and they said, this is pretty good. What else could you write? And I said, well, I write as much as you want. So they said, write everything. So I wrote it, and it ended up becoming a big, fat survival book, which remained a bestseller for many years and was also just recently released. The point being, from that, other people started coming forward because just being kind and always trying to serve others and do something for someone else and make their life better, people wanted to help me, so they kept coming to me. So I ended up making over 24 survival products, ended up making probably 6 books, contributing to another 6 books, 50 shows, 1 film, and all of that was an accident, but it all happened because I made it my life's mission to serve others, taking care of people, and they tend to take care of you and take care of everything else. And that's the kind of leadership that I admired when I was coming up in the ranks. I remember a Green Beret colonel, we were going to dinner with the staff, and there was somebody broken down on the side of the road, and he just decided he's going to pull over on the interstate and help push them off the road. Of course, we all jumped out of our car to help, and I was really impressed because we only had an hour for lunch, and he took that time out to help someone with no expectation, no planning, just to do the right thing. And I was like, that's the kind of leadership that I admired. That's the kind of leadership that I emulated. And it all got distilled down to, hey, as a leader, if you take care of your troops, they will take care of the mission. serving others. So as I kind of led this dual life of my military service, my contracting work, and my media opportunities, it just always kept coming back to the same sort of message and mission, which is try to serve others. So that said, just so you have some background, after 10 years, I retired from Special Forces in 2011, and then I did probably 5 years of a lot of TV work, and then as you know, the pendulum swings back and forth, I ended up going back towards contracting. I ended up in 2019 doing combat search and rescue for State Department in Afghanistan. In 2020, I got to be honored and work with Special Operations Command as a Special Forces subject matter expert. My primary focus is on working on a language translation device, but I work with amazing leadership, amazing special ops guys from all four branches, PhD engineers, and it's just wonderful to see all the things that these people are doing to try to make America and our military and our operators have a better life. So keeps coming back, service, serve others, look after others. Everything else will kind of fall into place. So that said, where I am now is I've been very blessed. I'm still working with Special Operations Command. I have my lovely wife, Ruth, my wonderful youngest son, Gabriel. I've just had my third grandchild. And all of these blessings I would have never seen when I was that 14-year-old kid getting shot and stabbed and survival on the streets. And I never would have seen it when I was in the military because I just focused on doing my mission, trying to be a good team member and do the best job that I could on whatever the mission was. And we always had a saying that you're only as good as your next mission. And that always resonated with me. It taught me, hey, stay humble. It's never over till you're pushing up daisies. The mission is never done till you're back at Fort Livingroom. Just always take care of your people. They'll take care of the rest. That said, sorry, I had to take a water break. That said, I just want to leave you with this very important message. No matter how bad things look, there's always a way around, a way over, under, something you can do. Or maybe the message is that you need to back up, regroup, find a new direction, take a new path. But if you always make it your point, how can I make the lives of those people around me better? How can I make whatever my mission is better? How can I do the best that I possibly can? The rest of the things start to fall into place. But the big secret sauce here, I think for all of you guys, veterans who are maybe transitioning, maybe got out recently, maybe thinking about getting out as you're checking out this Amazon Warrior program, things to think about for you if media is a direction that you want to go. A lot of things have changed these days. You know, I mean, we've got Instagram and Facebook and Twitter and all the other TikToks. And so influencing has become a very big thing. And you can do that. Just find something that you love, that you believe in, that you're good at, become an expert at it, and share that knowledge with people. If you want to get into TV or film or writing or music, just focus on being the best that you can at it, being nice to people, being kind, trying, exploring. Don't be afraid to fail. You're going to fail. For every smart thing I know, I've messed it up 10 times prior, right? So the whole secret sauce here is build a network of brothers and sisters. I've been helping guys get into media for decades. I've got a handful of friends that are in the media. Most every special op guy or survival guy in media I know. And it's all because just trying to be a good person, trying to help people, and always keeping your mind and your eyes open to what's out there and what's available, and always do soul searching, asking yourself, what am I good at? What do I believe in? What do I really care about? What do I get passionate about? And for me, I was always passionate about teaching. So when I got a chance to be on TV and start teaching survival, it's like, you mean I can teach a million people at a time and not just 10 students per class? Heck yeah, I'll have some of that. And oh, you mean that thing can be played over and over and over so I don't have to go out and risk my life and get snake bit and mosquito bit and ticks and chiggers and all that every single time I take just 10 people out? Yeah, I'll have some of that. So the media is a very powerful tool for good if you choose to use it that way. So I do encourage, I mean, back in the World War II days, when that was over, we had, Hollywood was filled with great Americans, patriots, warriors, soldiers that got into music and Hollywood. And I believe we're at a time now where we can do that again. So I'm hoping that you, my brothers and sisters, my fellow veterans, will find an interest in the media, in whatever form, whatever subsection of it you want to get into, writing, music, art, whatever. I encourage you to go for it, but also keep yourself working on something else, you know, focus on bread and butter stuff, taking care of family, paying the bills, because there's some kind of magic about when you go out and do things. If you're busy with something else, it just makes you, I think, more interesting and more interested. The more you learn, the more you know, the more you realize you don't know, the more you realize you need to learn. So you're constantly studying. And in short, by trying to serve others, you're always bettering yourself. And I think that's my final message for you. All of you people out there watching the Amazon Warrior program, checking this out, just know that those bad times that I had as a kid led to me becoming a Green Beret. Those times that I ended up surviving on the street led to me becoming a survival expert. Becoming a survival expert accidentally led to me becoming a media guy. And becoming a media guy has allowed me to be able to share my message with you in hopes that you'll be able to take this torch and carry yourself and then pass it on to the next generation. That said, I'm recording this now because I just finished doing a bunch of, sadly, news interviews and documentaries about the Petito laundry case. I'm also currently working on survival booze, on a survival gun, on a survival family cartoon, and I'm getting ready to go overseas and film another show for a big network. So I'm very blessed, but that's why I can't be here in person. I just want to say thank you for listening. I hope that some of this will be helpful and useful to you, and I wish you all the best. God bless.